And they were so bold. They took their stand. They were firm in their witness. Looking at the fiery furnace, they did not change their mind. Anytime I read about them, I ask myself, can I do it? But don't worry, we are coming to liking some things to that. If you look at Daniel chapter 3, an image was made that everybody should bow down to that image. But this witness, the witness of God, the resolute ones, the ones that will not bow down to circumstances, they said, no, we are not bowing down. Daniel chapter 3, when they reported them to the king called on them. They were not even afraid of the earthly king. I pray that the Lord will give us the grace to be a true witness of our faith in the name of Jesus. Let's read Daniel chapter 3, verse 12. Verse 12, they said, there are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. They serve not thy God, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men before the king. They brought them before the king. And look at what happened. And the king started communing with them, telling them, why have you done this? Don't you understand that if you don't bow down to that image, you are going to fire? Look at the response of these three Hebrew men from verse 16 of Daniel chapter 3. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning, fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thy hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. There are a lot of gods nowadays. Amen. There are a lot of gods. On Sunday, a woman brought her son to me in Ireland. That this boy, I don't understand. I'm trying to take him to Nigeria. I said, Nigeria. I said, don't worry. I have them, all these teenagers. I called the boy. I said, oh, my son also tells us that we are so weird. All of us, you are fussy. So he started laughing. He said, yes, yes, I can identify with that. I'm talking about the gods of this world. I'm talking about the king, how they are luring people not to stand by what they are witnessing, what they believe in. The devil is even in a subtle way taking this, our children. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, any child, any adult, any teenager that has been indirectly initiated, I stand on this altar of Jehovah. I cancel the initiation in the name of Jesus. Have you not heard about a boy, maybe 20 years old or 18, that killed the father and cut the father into pieces? Put the father in the box. Because the God of this world, they want to be like their mates. Amen. Everyone in this chapter, they were bowing down to the thing that the king, but these three boys, they said, no, we will not do it. And as I was praying for that boy, did you know? I prayed for him because there was no time. But he came back and said, I'm sweating, Pastor Grace, I'm sweating. I said, oh my God, okay, let me continue. Did you know the demon started screaming? I said, who are you? What are you doing here? He refused to answer. How did you enter here? You will be surprised when I tell you. I have the video. All I want now is that how they're going to blur the face and I start to play it to these children. Xbox. He said, I came in through Xbox. And this boy has taken a knife before that he wanted to kill the brother. He came in through what? Xbox. And I say, he said, true game, and all his friends, they go out in the night. They are all together in the night. He doesn't know. They've initiated him also, his friends. And I said, which of the game? Call for Duty. All these children know Call for Duty. Anyone that has ever played Call for Duty, I'm going to dedicate oil. All your hand that they have anointed for you to go and kill somebody. Whoa, you will say Pastor Grace has come on. I have it recorded. Any one of you that has done Call for Duty, look at three Hebrew men, they refuse to bow down to the God of Nebuchadnezzar. Why are you bowing down to the God of Nebuchadnezzar? They were young boys. Let all the schools be doing it. You take your stand. Look at that language, Call for Duty. Is it not calling them for duty? Call. Call off. It's not call off. They are deceiving you. He's calling you to come and do duty. Every child that starts to do those things, they become wayward in the house. When you talk to them, they say, are they not doing it to us? Amen. What are we saying? These three Hebrew men, they refused to bow down. And at the end of the day, God was glorified in their life. When a true witness passes through fire, the Almighty God is always with them. When all your friends desert you because you are not doing what they are doing, who is going to be with you? God Almighty will be with you. God Almighty will be with you. Isaiah 43 verse 1 to 2 says, when thou passest through fire, I will be with you. When you pass through waters, I will be with you. You don't need to look for popularity and start to bow down to the God of this world. You have to take your stand. These ones were young boys. Daniel was very young. He determined in his life that he will never bow down to the God of this world. And that decision makes the fire not to have effect on them. And the fire, they did not even smell it on their body. A true witness that faces marital problems, we take his or her stand. Some marital problems are taking some people to psychiatric hospital. But if you are a true witness, that is one fire of marital problem. If you are a true witness, do you know what will happen to you? You will pass through the fire. People will start to ask you and say, how did you manage when your husband ran away? How did you manage when your wife deserted you? Because you are a true witness, you're going to take your stand. You will not defile yourself. You will not defile yourself. A true witness, when they pass through fire, God always comes to their aid. He never leaves them alone. A lot of people, they pass through financial fire. Joblessness fire that has separated their home. Happy home, because of finances, we just scatter. But happy home that are witness, I mean true witness, they will pass through financial hardship and their love will grow the more. Why? Because when they are passing through that fire, because they are true witness, because they are the ones that will never bend down because of any circumstances, God will always be with them. I don't know the fire you are passing through right now. What a fire of the involvement of in-laws in the family. A true witness will pass through that fire and their marriage will still stand. What a fire of barrenness Maybe the wife is not bringing forth a true witness. I'm mentioning fire one by one. Fire. Different fire. Different fire. We are not expecting Nebuchadnezzar to come and put physical fire now. There are fire. When you pass through fire and you are a true witness of Jehovah, then it will not kindle against you. It will not burn you. You will just come out of it. What a fire of immigration. I told you before that a sister came to me and said, Pastor Grace, so you were also an illegal immigrant when you were taking me around the lawyers to fix my own case. Who told you that I'm illegal immigrant? The Bible said the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. The moment I am born again, my father is the owner of the whole world. If I want to go and live in Finland now, I will just go there. I'll just stay there until I get their papers. Amen. God is always interested in the resolute people. People that are determined. Look at Zechariah. The wife of Zechariah, let's read that one. I'm just looking at our time before we start to pray. Zechariah, the life of Zechariah, they had the fire that is called barrenness. Luke chapter 1, verse 5. Whenever I read about Zechariah, I say, oh my God, these are faithful people, true witness. There was in the days of Herod, the king of Judah, a certain priest named Zechariah. I'm reading Luke chapter 1 verse 5. Of whose cause of Abia, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous. Can we read that together? And they were both righteous before who? God. Walking in the commandment and the ordinances of the Lord, blameless. You may be blameless and still be passing through fire. It is when you take your stand that you will come out gloriously. You have to take your stand. I remember when I had no paper, a lot of temptation. They will come to you, they'll say, they have some people that are disabled that cannot get out again. They will give you their paper. Thank God that there was a brother. I brought the DVD from Nigeria, Brother John. One tall brother like this. Mommy, we know him. He sings in the choir, you know. And the special number I brought, as he was singing that song, he was pointing finger that day. So I would sit down in front of the television, and I say, point at me. He said, what gain will you have when you gain the whole world and lose your soul? As he's pointing, I am looking at him as if he's pointing to me. I say, oh Lord, I shed all the temptations. I will not do anything contrary to the will of God. You will not do anything contrary to the will of God in Jesus' name. In the time of your turbulence, in the name of Jesus, you will take your stand. The Bible said these people, they were both righteous before God. They were blameless. And look at verse 7 and 8. And they had no child because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest office before God in the order of his course, he was still serving God. What is that thing that has happened to you that you are no more effective in your work for God? Are you a true witness? Or you are bread and butter Christian? Because certain things is not moving fine. You are not also moving fine with God. God is not interested in those people. God is interested in people that even when things are rough, they are still serving him. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 1, verse 25. God always removed the reproach in the life of the resolute ones. Those that will take their stand, those that are focused, He removed reproaches from their life. That is Luke chapter 1, verse 25. He said, thus has the Lord dealt with me in the days wherein he looked on me, and to take away my reproach among men. I decree, as you take your stand for the Lord, as things are getting worse and you are still singing that you love him, he will take away every reproach in the name of Jesus. Zechariah, going without a child, was not distracted, but he was faithful in the service of God. Are you a true witness? You may claim that you have never seen God or Jesus Christ physically. So also the examples that I have given, they didn't see him physically. I have more examples in the scripture. Do you trust him? Do you trust his words? His words. Can you trust your life into his hands? Can you trust your life into his hand? He's the only one that can help us. And he's looking for those people that he can vouch for, like that of Job. He told the devil, say, have you seen my servant Job? He's so focused, and Job said, and the devil said, it's because things are fine with him. Some of us are facing some things because God has vouched for us. That, it's because she's my daughter. Oh, it's because she's doing things right. Let her fail several times. She will deny you. Let her not get a job. She will deny you. Let this happen. She will deny you. But if you can take your stand, he will take away the reproach. In the mighty name of Jesus. Proverbs chapter 14. Proverbs 14, 25. Proverbs 14, 25. It says, a true witness delivereth a soul. A true witness delivereth a soul or saves souls. But a deceitful witness speaketh lies. A true witness. By taking your stand, you deliver other souls. They start to look at you that if you can pass through it, we also can pass through it. Your life of witness, your life of facing those things is waiting ahead to save others. They will be able to say that during your own period, as you face those things unshaken, they can also face it. A true witness saves souls. They deliver souls. But a deceitful witness speaketh lies. We have so many deceitful witnesses nowadays that they tell lies in order to make people comfortable. They don't want to tell them the truth so that they will not go away. That's why you see preachers, they start to shout up and down, you will kill your Goliath. You will have victory now. But they will not tell them that if you are living in sin, the righteous God is not interested in you. They won't tell them that. Only few witnesses that are true are telling the truth. And as they tell the truth to people, they save their soul. Jesus Christ is the true witness. Revelation 3:14. Jesus Christ is the true witness. No wonder he came to deliver. He came to save us. And the Bible is telling us in 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. 1 John 4:17. That as he is, so are we in this world. We must be a true witness. We must be like our Father. A true witness is one who engages in witnessing in order to save souls. Your life will witness. Your mouth will witness. Your relationship with people will witness for him. And people will be able to say, yes, this is a true witness. A true witness is one who engages in witnessing in order to save soul, in order to deliver soul. You cannot be a witness without witnessing. You cannot be a witness without what? Witnessing. And for you to be an effective witness, resolute one, determined witness, Jesus Christ advised you to tarry. He advised you to tarry. He advised you to wait on him. Tarry in the place of prayer so that he can empower you. So that he can empower you. And as you tarry, he wants you to tarry with a clear heart. That was why the apostles were not endued with power until they gathered together in one accord. They were given instruction in Acts of Apostles chapter 1. From Acts of Apostles chapter 1, verse 1 to 8, Jesus Christ was telling them how they should go and wait somewhere, how they should wait on him so that they can receive power. Until they got to Acts chapter 2, they waited in one accord. Is your heart cleared towards your brother? Is your heart cleared towards your sister? Is your heart cleared towards people around you? Those true witness that their heart is clear towards their husband, their wife, their sisters, their siblings, they are the one that will be endued with power. And the Bible tells us in Acts of Apostles chapter 1, verse 8, it says, ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost shall come upon you. It is then that you'll be able to be a resolute witness. Amen. You cannot be a real witness in this present world without power. But the mistake people are making is that when they are filled with the Holy Ghost, they just start to when they see cockroach coming, they start to run. When they see lizard, they run, because they are not with power. Tonight, you need power. Amen. You need power. Let's go to Acts of Apostles. We're going to start to pray now. Acts of Apostles chapter 1. And let's reason together that passage. Acts of Apostles chapter 1, verse 8. Let's read it together. It says, but ye shall receive what? When will you receive power? After that the Holy Ghost is what? And ye shall be witness unto me, both in where? Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. We talked about the olden days true witness. They were so bold. The power of God was with them. But Jesus Christ now saw that the world is getting more sophisticated. So when he ended up his assignment, he left behind the Holy Ghost. That these ones I'm looking at. Pornography will come. Evil films, movies will come. All these games will come. People will be doing all those evil things. They need power to resist sin. And that's why the Bible says, and ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Amen. No wonder the fire, lion of this world, situation of the world that are not permanent scare a lot of people. If you are just baptized with the Holy Ghost, temporary things will scare you. Things that are not permanent. Whatever you are passing through, they are not permanent. They've come, they will go. You start to say the story and say, oh, there was a time this was happening, but it is now this way. But before it becomes story, if you are not empowered, you'll be tired. You may be coming to church reluctantly. A lot of people are coming to church reluctantly. Amen. It's not that from their heart they are really happy that, oh, I'm going to meet my maker again. But tonight he wants to revive you. But if you are here, you are not born again. You cannot witness something you don't know about. Even if you have not seen the person, but if you have the knowledge, you can witness about that person. Romans chapter 12 verse 1 says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your body unto the Lord, a living sacrifice. There must be a presentation of your life to the one that you want to witness about. This God that you want to witness about, you must be identified with him. You must give your life to him. Then when you start to witness, then we call you a true witness. So if you are here tonight, you are not born again, you have not given your life to Jesus, it is time for you to do that. But if we are here, we are born again, and you are not yet baptized with the Holy Ghost, talk less of power. Immediately we are standing up, come before the altar. Amen. Because the Bible tells us in Mark 16:17, it said, "This sign shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out demons." They said they shall speak with new tongues. But if we are baptized with the evidence of speaking with tongues, you will rise on your feet. You start to ask for power. Power to be a true witness, O Lord. Power not to deny you. I told you about my principal that gave me thorough beating. The first thing they asked me when they took me to Ministry of Education is that I should deny God. Yes, where is the place? Ibadan. Ibadan was the head in a city in Nigeria, was the headquarter of Ilesha Ministry of Education. In their office, they said, "Don't you know the Bible that you are reading says that Jesus Christ came to turn father against son, to turn son against mother? He has come to disrupt everything. So why are you following such a person that is turning father against son?" So they now told me that for us to help you out, you have to deny that Jesus. I looked at them, shake my head. They said, "Take your education. I will never." Amen. "Take your what? Education." And they said, "Well, we can't help you. You have to go out." But thank God, they were not in Elisha. A principal that saw my result, that was not in their meeting when they were meeting about my case with the governor and everywhere, was looking for me. And that's why I sneak into that school. I finish my school cert. Amen. If you are not endued with power, circumstances will come that you will deny him. You need power. You need power to say no to the kingdom of darkness. You need power to say no at the verge of sin. "Hey, is the one that will marry me now? We have done engagement. Ah, have you come to the church?" If that man touches you, you have denied the faith. I give you an example, close example. It's not far of denying Christ. You need the power to resist the devil. You are alone in your house. Nobody is coming to visit you. You are just there saying, "Turn on that TV now. It's 1 a.m. You can see certain things." You need power to say, "No, I will not behold such things. Because it is written, if my eyes will make me stumble." Say, "I should pluck it out." "I'm not ready to pluck these eyes out." Rise on your feet. Start to talk to God. If you want to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, you can come here and say, "I am claiming Mark 16:17. Don't be tired. Some of you say, I've been coming out. A day is your day. Come out here and say, "Lord, it is written that I will speak with new tongues, that this is the sign." But if you are baptized with the evidence of speaking in tongues, I want you to start to talk to God and say, "Father, empower me, O Lord." It is not a prayer. It is not silent prayer.
Number one family-friendly comedy show is back. PC Entertainment presents the fourth edition of the Be Yourself Comedy Show. Featuring Shaggy Brown, Wami Lele, Kule Tatafo, comedian Femi, and Jetty. Music by Dare David, Kels Johnson, Stacy Egbo, Yinka Sachs, Praise in Dan, and DJ SM95. Hosted by international comedian MCPC. Tickets are available at Wazobia African Market, Trinity African Bar and Grill, Southwest African Market, and online at mcpc.tv. This event is brought to you by MoneyGram and Wazobia African Market. Proudly supported by Project Clothe a Child, 90.1 FM KPFT Houston, Millennium Broadcasting Channel, Distinction Television, Afrocentric TV, Speaks TV, Golden Icon, Shegungele International, and Christian Entertainment News. Come Sunday evening, August 31st, for the Be Yourself Comedy Show. Regular admission is $20 and VIP is $30. Located at RCCG Pavilion of Redemption, 15227 Old Richmond Road, Sugar Land, Texas 77498. The Blood.